Anybody out there? Oh my goodness. It's good to have those who are here, but man, it must be getting to the middle of summer. And everybody's... And that's the kind of day we're going to have. It's a blessing to be here, and thank you for being here to come and worship this morning. Basically, we have a normal week, and I am thankful. We have been inundated with funerals throughout the last 6 weeks, and I'm looking forward to a couple of days without a funeral, just so that life can normalize for a moment. As we come this day, let us be in an attitude of prayer. Heavenly God, we come before you and ask that you will lead us and guide us as we come this day. Let the words that come to our mouths, the thoughts that come to our brains, the meditations that are in our hearts, give to us a sense of your presence and your love. In all things, let us bring our hearts to you to worship and praise your holy name. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us stand for you have, Lord, you have come to the lakeshore.
Thank you. I'd like to ask you to join me in the call to worship. Called by God, we have come to worship.
Called by Christ, we have come to follow.
Called by the Spirit, we have come to rejoice.
Called together, we will listen and pray.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Playing the wrong song, I'm sorry.
One, two, three.
We yearn for a heavy catch, a full church, an abundant feast. Forgive us, God, when we are too tired to cast our nets one time, when we're too stubborn to do things a little differently. Have mercy on us when we are too afraid to dive into deep waters and take a risk. Grant us grace that we may proclaim your word, work for your kingdom, and trust your promises. In Jesus' name.
Our scripture this morning comes from Luke chapter 5, verses 5 through 11. And Simon said, "Master, we've been fishing hard all night and haven't caught even a minnow. But if you say so, I'll let out the nets." It was no sooner said than done. A huge haul of fish, straining the nets past capacity. They waved to their partners in the other boat to come help them. They filled both boats, nearly swamping them with the catch. Simon Peter, when he saw it, fell to his knees before Jesus. "Master, leave. I am a sinner and can't handle this holiness. Leave me to myself." When they pulled in that catch of fish, awe overwhelmed Simon and everyone with him. It was the same with James and John, Zebedee's sons, co-workers with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "There is nothing to fear. From now on, you will be fishing for men and women." And they pulled their boats up on the beach, left the nets and all, and followed him.
Let us pray. Gracious and heavenly God, we give you thanks for this day. And as we come, we ask that you will speak to us through your word and let these words, O Lord, be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Let's see if any of you know this commercial. Let's see if it works. Any of you ever had Slinky in your life? I know I've had many of them. Most of the ones that I had never ended up back in the Slinky mode because they always got outstretched and overstretched and here. But today we're going to be looking at the faith lessons that the Slinky and the Slinky Dog can teach us in our lives and as we grow forward in faith. Now, we hear the story in the gospel of Jesus calling Simon and James and John. And one of the things about that story is that Jesus comes in, the guys have been out all night long, they haven't caught even a minnow. Now, you gotta think about that. Minnow swimming schools up by the shore. But they would have been casting their nets out into the larger lake, and they did not catch anything. And as they cast their nets, they had worked all night long because that was the best time to fish. They came up on shore, they were cleaning their nets, they were putting it all away, and Jesus said, "Hey, let's go back out. I want permission. And Simon Peter goes, no, I'm tired. I want to go to bed. I've been working all night, and you want me to go back out? Jesus said, trust me. Now, that's the most important part, is that Jesus said, go out and give it a try. Trust him. See if he'll do anything that will make a difference. And so Peter gets back in his boat, and he goes out with Jesus, and he haphazardly throws out the net. And before the net can even get totally unfurled under the water, it is filled to overflowing with fish, and it's beginning to sink the boat, and he has to call into James and John, hey, come and help me, it's filled up! And they're going, what? They get out there, and it takes both boats to take the fill of the nets, and they fill up the boats, and they go in. And Simon says, get away from me. Just get away from me. I am a sinner. I can't handle all this holiness. There's something about you that's different, and I cannot live up to it. And therefore, get away from me. I just want to be a fisherman. Jesus says, no problem. You won't be a fisherman, you will be a fisher of men and of women. And when he said that, you got to think about this for a minute. The boats were filled to overflowing. The nets were still filled as they had brought the fish in, and now here's the crux. They left everything on the shore and got up and followed. Now that takes some trust. That takes some trust. Now what does that have to do with you and me? Well, first of all, it causes us to trust that when the head calls, we're to follow. When the heart calls, we're to follow. Especially when the head and the heart are following Jesus. Now, there's this wonderful scene in Toy Story 2 that takes the Slinky Dog on a journey. Okay, let's see if that one will play for us. Now they have just escaped notice that Slinky got just a little bit stretched. And he was trying to do what he needed to, but where his head was, the tail wasn't. Have you ever noticed that that's kind of like it is in our lives? That when our head decides to go somewhere, the rest of us doesn't always want to catch up and is sometimes following. Now, he jumped out head first, but in our lives, generally, our head goes first, at least we hope. And the rest of us has to catch up. And so, yeah, it's following along, trying to get through this one scene, and I could not find it, where he goes, yeah, you know, if I get stretched too far, my head can be in America. My tail end is in Madagascar. And it takes to catch up, to get there. Now, in our faith, when we come to live our lives of faith, one of the things that we have to learn is that very often our head and our heart see something. They grow in a way that is new and exciting, and they begin to say, oh, I want some of that. I want to know where that is. I want to have that in my life. Have you ever gone on a retreat and found yourself coming home from that retreat, and then you're going, oh, if my life would always just be like this, and we get home, and then we walk into the house, and there's dirty dishes on the counter, and there's laundry to do, and there's beds to make, and there's a job to go back to, and our heads still trying to stay up in the cloud, and the rest of our life is lagging way behind. You see, one of the things that Slinky-Dog teaches us about faith is that it takes patience and tenacity to let our faith grow to where our head and our heart hears about the new items and the new things about faith so that the rest of us can catch up. Now, how do we hear that? How do we know that? What are we talking about? Now, I've had stand up. He wanted to take a nap, that stretch. But, have you ever gone to a class or a session or go somewhere and you've learned about a new kind of prayer and you say, I want to have some of that. I want to get that in my life. You want it to be up and going on in your life and you want to put it in there and you take off and for about 3 days you do it. And then all of a sudden, the lessons are left behind, and you're going, why can't I do that? Why can't I keep that going? Why can't I learn it? I just give up. And then the next time you go to the session like that, or a retreat, or a class, and you learn about it again, you go, I remember that, and I want to try it again. And so you do it, and about 3 days later, you're back where you were. See, the thing about faith is that we have to decide what things we are learning and which ones will be most helpful for me. Now, as I'm starting to get older, I did say I was growing up, I just said I was getting older. As I'm starting to get older, one of the things that I'm learning is that contemplative prayer is nothing I could ever do when I was younger. If you haven't noticed, I'm a rather strong extrovert. And I like to talk, and even if there's nobody around, I generally end up talking because I have to have that going on. In fact, I'm such a strong extrovert that when I read the thing about me, it said, in order to think or know what you're thinking, a very strong expert has to speak or write what they're doing in order to be able to have a thought process complete. That's me. And I've had some people look at me and go, why do you always have to tell so many stories? Why do you have to start a story and then start it over and say it again? Because that's how my mind works. And so contemplative prayer I was taking a course in my Doctor of Ministry studies that I started on contemplative prayer. And they took us out to this farm, and they said, it's 8:45 right now. At 9 o'clock, you are going silent. At lunch, you are going to eat silently. And you are going to stay silent until 4 o'clock when we come and debrief about your silence. 9 to 4, without saying a word, is what we were supposed to do. I'm going to tell you, those trees down near Washington, D.C., and the little pond, and the ducks all got a talking to because I couldn't handle the silence. And others in the class would come, and we were out walking and doing different things, and others would come. But over the years, I found that contemplative prayer, because I kept trying to practice it. And finally I realized that I can't try contemplative prayer for 8 hours. I have to try contemplative prayer for 5 minutes. And I learned that, hey, you know what? I can stay quiet for 5 minutes if I'm focusing on God. And as I got to the place where I was comfortable with 5 minutes, I moved to 10 minutes. And I came to the place where I spent 3 days alone in contemplative prayer. And I think the only time I said something was when I stubbed my toe. And that was just a reflex rather than. And in that time, I was able to hear the voice of God. Maybe it has to do with reading our scriptures, or and we go, where do I start? Anywhere. How do I keep going? Read 3 verses a day. Read 1 a day. Until you get to the place where you are finding that the scriptures are easier to read and you begin to understand. In fact, make sure that you find a translation that your head and heart can understand. If this was my head, I was trying to read an old King James with the old Queen King's English, and my head went, because I could not figure out any of that. I picked up the same text in a contemporary English version, and I go, that's what it was all about. Make sure you find the ways that are going to help you do it so that you can, with patience and tenacity, step forward and step into the faith that you're wanting to grow. John Wesley. Now, he's the founder of our church. He went to Oxford Seminary. And he was an ordained Episcopal priest. And he came to America, and he got over here, and the only thing that the Americans wanted to do with him was ship him back to England. He had a terrible time. They didn't like what he had to say. They didn't like where he was going. They didn't like what he taught. That everything he did was just... So finally he said, I'm heading back. And he got on a boat. He was on a boat with a group of Moravians. And their pastor, Peter Baylor, was there. And John, being an Episcopal or Anglican priest, met up with him, and they started talking. And as they were going across the Atlantic Ocean from Georgia over to England, the storms were so bad that anybody who was not used to riding on a ship was riding over the edge of a ship. Not you. You know, that's all I'm going to say. You can figure the rest of that out now, what they were doing. And John went downstairs and into the bottom of the boat, where if you're on a boat, the worst place to be is underneath when there's a lot of rocking. And there's all the people from Peter Baylor's church, and they're down there reading psalms and singing hymns and praying and going, God, we're going to make it. And John went back upstairs and said, Peter, how are they doing this? Where did they get the assurance that God is with them? I'm ready to jump ship just so I don't get sick again. And Peter goes, well, this is what you need to do. You need to preach faith and assurance until you have it. Even if you don't have it, preach it until you have it. He goes, and then once you have it, you won't be able to do anything but preach it. And it was late at Aldersgate Street when John was in a Bible study on Paul's letter to the Romans. They were reading the opening part of that. And the commentary on Romans said that we are justified by faith and not by works. That it is nothing about what we do, but about what God does for us. That John had his heart strangely warmed, and he said, and my heart was strangely warmed, and I knew that God would save and forgive a sinner, even a sinner such as I. And from that time on, he had assurance, and he preached it. But he had been preaching it before, even to the point of getting kicked out of all of the Anglican churches in London. They would not let him in as a priest to preach, because he was preaching this faith that they did not know. And the hierarchy did not like it, because they didn't know it either. Kind of like Jesus and the Pharisees. And we have to have in our own hearts the same thing that comes to life as we would if we were a leader. And there's an old Chinese leadership proverb that says, if you think you're a leader, and you are leading people, you turn around and find nobody following. You just out for a long walk. You know, that's an important thing for us to remember with our hearts and our minds. If we're not following, we are just going forward. But if we have that patience and tenacity to keep on trying, do you know that you have to take 21 days of doing something different to change a habit that you have always done the same way? If you don't believe me, try brushing your teeth with your opposite hand. Now, I'm right-handed. I can brush my teeth, no problem with my right hand. I can get all corner. I'm brushing the inside of my nose. I'm going to my ear. I'm going everywhere because I can't seem to find the right way to do that because my muscles are not conditioned for it. And it takes 21 days of training and retraining of our lives and our hearts and our minds to be able to change and transform ourselves. Now, back to Jesus and Simon. It took Simon 3 years to totally trust Jesus. In fact, at the end, while Jesus was being on trial and being beaten and prepared for death, and Peter was in the courtyard, he couldn't trust that Jesus was truly the one at that point. And when they said to him, weren't you with the Galilean? No, I don't know that man. Weren't you with that Jesus? No, I don't know him. Peter was having that same issue of his head and his mind were able to do it, but his life couldn't quite hold on. And finally, when they asked him that third time, he says, I do not know him. I do not know what you're talking about. I do not know that man. And then he ran off crying. wasn't until the Holy Spirit came, when they were in hiding, that he began to find that his patience and tenacity, his learning and his walking, his journeying with Jesus transformed his life. I would have thought, man, a boat full of fish. I want to hang out with this guy, and I'm going to trust that he knows what he's doing. But all along the way, Peter kept getting the wrong answers. All along the way, Peter had foot and mouth disease. He was sticking that foot in all the time. I'm going to guess he had the cleanest toes of any of them, because he just always was saying the wrong thing. But then what happened? Peter became one of the greatest disciple apostles that we can remember. And his story is the story that reminds us of even a person like you and me. When we hear the story, in our heads, and it begins to move in our hearts, and even though the rest of us tends to follow and lag behind, if we continue to grow, and that takes work, at that point we'll find that we are there, standing right beside Jesus. Oh, we may have moments we need to grow further and catch up, and grow further and catch up. But faith takes the story of Slinky and gives us the ability to grow.
Thank you.
flowers this morning are in loving memory of Charles Cornish from Kim. God in your mercy. A concern for from Sue and Doug Pearson. They're having health concerns, and this is from Kim Cornish. God in your mercy. A concern for a friend, Dennis, from Judy Smith, healing after a fall and his surgery. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We have a joy from it says my grandson is so proud to be a Marine recruit. I don't know who it's from. But God is good.
All the time.
A concern for Mary Moore in the hospital because of a heart attack from Anna Peterson. Lord, in your mercy.
Sure.
A concern for Marlene and Roy Bingston from Shirley Hicks. Safe travels from Colorado. Lord, in your mercy. A joy from Arnie. Have not had a migraine headache. Oh, this is Annie, I'm sorry. Have not had a migraine headache since June 6th. Started a new medication. Thanksgivings to the scientists who developed it. God is good.
All the time.
Prayers for Elia from Annie. She had three teeth pulled.
She's going to have three teeth.
Oh, she's going to have them pulled. Okay. Lord, in your mercy, please be with Elia. A concern for Marley. It's a dog. And it was Elia's. It's from Elia. That he'd be safe in heaven. Lord, in your mercy. This is a concern for Lindy Vance, Stacy, and John from Bart Palamaki for health concerns. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
This is a concern from Kevin, for Kevin from Nicole Still, recently diagnosed with ALS. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
This is a joy and a concern for Jean Vanderfort from Trina Johnson. Successful surgery, healing now, may need radiation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And God is good.
All the time.
And the last one is from Pastor Bob for hopefully funeral times. I can't read it all.
Jim Mead's funeral or memorial services this afternoon.
Right.
And Reno Kistola, is that how you say his name?
Yes, Kistola.
Is Thursday. And he passed away this last week.
Okay. Lord, in your mercy. And then I just want to add to those that are down at Gusmacher working today, just prayers for them, and it's been a great time, so God is good.
All the time.
Let's pray. Gracious God, give us the ability to have the patience and the tenacity, the willingness to be stretchable and to catch up with ourselves, to have vision and to see where you are calling us, and then to begin the process of moving toward that. Here, help us as individuals and as a church to always be in the process of following you, taking new steps forward and giving ourselves the ability to adapt and move. For we always prefer the place where we are or those happy places where we have been. And yet we find that over the many centuries, you have shown us that the church can move forward and can address the needs of communities and people in the world as the world continues to change. And as we seek vision, help us to be open to the changes that need to be made so that we can reach a world that is searching for something they cannot find it on their own. And that the only place that they can find it is in you. So give us that sense of your presence in our lives, nudging us forward, pulling us forward, pushing us when you need to, so that we are able to be vitally alive. And in those times when we have worries and we have frustrations and when things are not going our way, give to us the comfort of your presence and show us that you are holding us in your hands, that you are comforting us in your arms, that you are loving us with your grace. And help us to follow your Son, so that when he comes to us and says, toss the net out more time, and we're going, oh, I'm too tired. It'll never work. I've already done it all night long. We can say, sure, God, I'm willing. And then as we do, we find your grace. Let your Spirit move us each and every day through your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray these words when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As an act of giving and a participation in worship, we take this time to offer ourselves to God through the presentation of tithes and offerings. The offering plates are here. I do remind you that you can also give through the website or through mail or however it is that you would like to, but I'd like you to come forward at this time. Let us receive. Continue us on the journey towards giving all of our lives to you, so that in everything we are serving and honoring you. Through gifts, through tithes, through worships, through service, and through our faith. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Go now in God's peace. Amen.